This video is brought to you by Warped Kart Racers on Apple Arcade. Get warped into the ultimate kart racing game, featuring the stars of 20th Television's hit animated shows, including Family Guy, American Dad, King of the Hill, and Solar Opposites. Take control of over 20 playable characters and beat your friends in riotous races and brutal battles. Master racing and battling across 16 maps drawn from fan-favorite episodes. Play an extensive single-player campaign or compete in 8-player multiplayer matches. To find out more about this wacky new racer, click the link in the description below or go to patreon.com/jennyguys so that I can afford an Apple Arcade subscription. A little over a month ago, I released a video about Nintendo's infamous mobile gacha game, Mario Kart Tour, where I essentially surmised that, despite the game's prevalent and predatory monetization, it still has some really interesting and fun ideas that make it worth looking at. The high score system and its focus on stringing together combos really adds a unique flavor to the typical Mario Kart formula, the courses and characters it adds to the series are as good as ever, and if they were to find a way to remove the gacha, the game would fit right at home with the rest of Nintendo's catalog. So of course, 5 days after that video came out, Nintendo announced that they found a way to remove the gacha. Well, holy shit. I genuinely did not expect that. At least this aged better than my last video to precede major news. On October 4th, 2022, the Battle Mode Tour kicked off the fourth year of Mario Kart Tour with several major changes to the game we all know. Balloon Battle joined the fray as a new mode in both online and ranked, several quality of life changes were made to the UI, 3 additional cups were added to each tour, and most relevantly, the pipe you fire by spending rubies has been replaced by the Spotlight Shop, the gacha ecosystem where you spend infinite amounts of money on rubies for a chance of getting everything you want has been retrofitted into a freemium experience where you spend a finite amount of money on a firm chance of getting what you want. This has transformed the economy of Tour and how one must approach the game. And I don't just mean that in an ethical sense, because yes, not having gambling mechanics will always be better than the opposite. No, this change has also affected the game in a business sense, a gameplay sense, and even a psychological sense, not all of which is necessarily for the better. Gacha may be gone, but greed is still greed, and as I stated in my previous video, games like this are designed to make money first, entice the consumer second. So now that this update has had enough time to settle with the player base, I have to wonder, did killing gacha as I suggested truly fix Mario Kart Tour? Before we begin, I do recommend watching my initial tour video if you haven't already. This video will purely be covering the complexities introduced by this update, so if you need a refresher on how things once were, definitely check that out now. Likewise, I do apologize for going to the Mario Kart Tour well twice in a row. I tend not to do follow-up videos like this, but the removal of gacha was so central to my prior thesis that I couldn't not cover it. However, I can't talk about said removal of gacha without mentioning the other major additions of the 3.0 update. So let's take a brief detour into the actual poster boy of Tour Year 4, Battle Mode. Remember how in my previous video, I described the movement in Mario Kart Tour feeling more like a skateboard than a car? How it's less tight and precise than the console games, but it works for the stylish, combo-focused gameplay that Tour excels at? Well, it goes without saying that Battle Mode is going to need to work differently. Part of why racing in Tour feels the way it does is because of the auto-acceleration and smart steering systems. Yes, you can turn off smart steering in Tour like you can in 8 Deluxe, and some players do prefer that for shortcut use and additional freedom, but for most, smart steering is just better. Unlike the pushier and overbearing smart steering of 8 Deluxe, Tour smart steering mostly just smooths out the edges of the road, allowing one to comfortably race down a path and perform interesting maneuvers without being limited by bumping into barriers. Unfortunately, that system isn't going to work in battle mode. Since Tour always has auto acceleration on, you can't just brake to turn around or reverse when slamming into a wall like you can in other games. You're always going to be moving forward, even if you slam into a wall or get stuck in a corner. It makes smart steering feel less like a smoothing of the edges and more like a waffling of the controls. Bump into a wall and you have to awkwardly noodle yourself into another direction to keep going. Don't bump into a wall and you just drive forward very slowly without much freedom to the controls. The strategies that it takes to win Balloon Battle do not match up with the strategies it takes to maintain a combo, so the controls feel considerably less satisfying than they used to. If racing in Tour feels like like controlling a skateboard, then battling in Tour feels kinda like controlling a bumper car. It's not unfun, there's certainly mayhem to be had, but it's not particularly exhilarating to control either. This isn't to say that there's no fun to be had in battle mode, because that's also not true. While the controls aren't exactly a clean fit, the core gameplay is still battle mode, or at least a version of battle mode that isn't Mario Kart 8's. For the first time in quite a while, Balloon Battle is an elimination-focused mode again, so losing all of your balloons means you're out of the race. Instead of that sending you out of the running entirely, you're now placed onto a platform that orbits the arena to throw items back into the fray. This way, if you're eliminated first, you're not just sitting around and twiddling your thumbs for 3 minutes, and if you survive until later, you have to deal with way more hazards than prior players. It's an organic way to have the best of both worlds, combining the competitiveness and intensity of classic battle mode with the even participation of modern battle mode. A part of me does worry that this mechanic could limit the types of battle courses they add, as the three they have so far are admittedly on the simple side, but I imagine that could change once the developers and players are acquainted with this mode. It'd be pretty disappointing to not get more elaborate maps like 64 Block Fort or Wii Funky Stadium, so for that we'll have to wait and see. As it pertains to multiplayer though, Battle is a welcome addition to the online rotation that more than makes up for the loss of gold races. Even if it did take them 2 whole weeks to get it running, I won't complain, it gave me more time to slack on this video. That said, Battle is not exclusive to multiplayer in the way that it has been in past games. 4 of the now 15 cups feature Balloon Battle against CPUs as one of their challenges, including sometimes both ranked cups. It's weird. On one hand, the way that the scoring system works in Battle is genuinely a bit refreshing. It's much harder to build up combos in the traditional sense, like stringing together drift boosts or jumping off of trick ramps. Higher level drivers can get frenzies and gliders have their multipliers, but these won't automatically save you from careless battling the same way they might from careless racing. Ditto for the bonus tallies that higher level DKGs have. If you're not playing actively, you miss out on the other score boosting bonuses. Knocking out an opponent gives you more and more points the longer a battle goes on. I already mentioned how hard it is to survive when eliminated CPUs are continually throwing items into the fray, and with 2 balloons instead of the traditional 3, you actually do need to think to survive. Wins can't essentially be bought by ramming a level 8 driver into an item box and pulling off frenzy after frenzy. If you're constantly dropping all 3 of your items before touching an item box to attempt triggering a frenzy, you're not only making yourself vulnerable, but you risk those very same items outright knocking you out. It's a new bent on Tour's risk versus reward luck-based structure that helps break some of the monotony of ranked, even if it does accentuate some of the mode's problems as well. While the frenzy system isn't quite as essential in battle as it is in racing, it's still extremely overpowered, particularly for items like the Boomerang or Lucky 7 that don't leave a trail of hazards that might later affect oneself. Simply having 3 item slots rather than 1 or 2 is going to give an inherent advantage to people with several high-ends and a major disadvantage to those without. Particularly so, with only 3 battle courses so far, meaning the number of favored high-ends is still exceptionally low. If you don't have enough rubies to buy a corresponding unit from the Spotlight Shop, you are going to be at a disadvantage. Oh yeah, we can talk about the Spotlight Shop now. This is gonna be interesting. This is the Spotlight Shop, the new way to obtain drivers, carts, and gliders now that the randomized tour pipes are gone. Here, instead of spending 45 to 450 rubies to clear out a pipe and earn all of its guaranteed spotlights, you spend a fixed cost of 150 rubies for drivers and 100 for carts and gliders, across all high-end units. Much like the old system, each tour has a guaranteed spotlight that's available all week, but now that's balanced out by extra daily spotlights that rotate between a finite selection of existing high-ends. It's basically the usual daily select shop, but replace coins with rubies and tickets or common units with exclusive high-ends. At last, gone are the days of pretending to be excited when your gold pipe just brings out a glider. Yes, a glider! That's literally just what I wanted! Literally my first choice! Also, my favorite Persona 5 girl is Haru. Overall, the update was a resounding success. It's much less complicated than the gacha system and doesn't require you to gamble, so they did it. They fixed the game. They did not fix the game. At least, not entirely. First things first, 150 rubies for a driver is steep. There's no dancing around that. Even with the price overhaul to rubies now ranging from 4 for $2 to 170 for $70, you're still looking at somewhere around $140 for the 350 rubies you'd need. need to buy the driver cart and glider of the week. That's technically less than the $230 it would have cost to buy 450 rubies and empty a pipe, but that's still an insane amount, especially when you consider that other similar service games sell costumes or bundles for $20, which is also too much, but that's another can of worms. These prices are doubly strange in comparison to those of Mii costumes, which have been purchasable with rubies for 6 months now and range from 70 to 100 rubies each. The fact that these spotlighted drivers are worth double of their Mii costume equivalents is kind of absurd, and it makes obtaining new units feel significantly harder than it was before. It's technically not that much harder, but emphasis on the feels part. For example, when you put 150 rubies into a gacha pipe, that would produce 33 pulls, approximately one-third of the average 100 pull pipe. Adding in the free pipes that you got each tour, that would round up to around 35. 35 things for 150 rubies. Were all 35 of those things useful? Not at all. Most of them would be normal or super rarity units that you already had dozens of, and you only had a one-third chance of getting the spotlight you actually wanted. But even if you didn't, you still got 35 things, some of which might have even been spotlights or high-ends that you didn't specifically pull for, but are welcome surprises nonetheless. Furthermore, if you took it a bit further and spent 450 rubies to empty a pipe, you'd have gotten 100 things, including all of the pipe's spotlights, one or two high-ends, and dozens upon dozens of normal and super rarity units, probably enough to level one of them up. Yes, it was gambling, but not in the real-life way where you can tangibly lose something. You were losing your own money if you paid for rubies, but in-game you were getting everything you wanted and how. Contrast this with the spotlight shop, where just three spotlights, a driver cart, and glider would cost 350 rubies. Yes, you're guaranteed to get the things you want, but if you want all three units, it costs about the same as it would have to empty a pipe, which would have also guaranteed you got what you want while also giving you 94 to 97 other things of varying quality. I'm not trying to defend gacha at all, because I contend that gambling mechanics in games are inherently predatory and should not be in a series aimed at children, but in terms of tour specifically, I can definitely understand why some feel put off by this change. Again, it may not be that much worse, but it feels way less productive. However, I should note that the theoretical 35 pulls you would have gotten from your 150 rubies technically still exist. They're just spread out into two different avenues, tour gifts and multiplayer pipes. Yes, somewhat surprisingly, pipes were not entirely removed in this update. On top of the remaining token shop pipes and daily challenge pulls, you now get up to 12 green pipes from standard tour gifts, the rewards you get for achieving high scores in tours, with 15 more being given out in the gold pass, two of which are gold pipes that guarantee a high-end pull. That's 27 pipes, just a bit short of the 35 you would have gotten with 150 rubies, but guaranteed whether you buy the current spotlight or not. I know that's not a one-to-one comparison, as these pipes aren't the direct results of your ruby spending and won't necessarily give as good of items that a full pipe would have, but from a design perspective, it makes a lot of sense. As annoying as those constant normal and super level units are, they are a part of the game balance, and taking them away entirely could lead to major issues. New players need their normal units to get started. Novice players need their normal units to level up and climb the ranks. The main difference between these two systems is that now those units are unlocked by everyone through normal gameplay instead of being tied mostly to spending rubies. The brand new multiplayer pipe is a good example of this change, as it can unlock up to 30 pulls per tour through continued online play, which anyone can access. While these features are probably just there to keep low-level units in the running while shifting to a less randomized income model, they at the very least mitigate the feeling of slower progression that the Spotlight Shop initially seemed to bring. They're not exactly game changers, but when taking a long break from spending rubies to save up for your next Spotlight Shop purchase, these randomized methods are your only chance at unlocking new gear, and that is a step up from the times where paid pipes were the only way to unlock gear at all. Well, besides the token and daily select shops, but those weren't exactly the most reliable. Again, if you wanted this update to remove the luck element entirely, this probably isn't going to satisfy you. But if you tolerated the luck while wanting more consistent unlock methods, this is definitely a step in the right direction. One that is unfortunately accompanied by a pretty major step back. The true biggest flaw in this update, even more than the spotlight shop prices or scattershot pipes, is the changes that they made to ranked. It generally works how it used to, but the rewards are simultaneously more balanced and less substantial than before. On one hand, they already seem to be giving out way more drivers, carts, and gliders than they used to. This was certainly common before, but since year 4 began, they've added 3 super rarity drivers and 2 high-end units to the ranked reward rotation, and they're not nearly as limited anymore either. Literally in the anniversary tour, I could not get the white me costume because it was exclusive to the number one ranked cup winner and I was not a gacha whale. But 1 week later in the battle tour, I was able to get the red racing toad despite ranking in fourth. That's neat. This and the removal of gacha make ranked way more engaging and attainable for the average player. Or so you would think, because hidden in this change is the fact that the number of rubies you can win in ranked has been cut in half. Before, you could get 10 to 50 rubies in a week depending on your tier and rank, but now it ranges between 5 and 25. When factoring this into how many free rubies you can get each tour, the range drops from 64 to 169 to 54 through 119, so an average of 90 to an average of around 75. Keep in mind, in the old system, that 90 could have bought you 20 pulls from a tour pipe, while in the new system, 75 can't buy anything. If you're a free player trying to make your way up ranked, you go from having a 1 in 5 chance of getting the spotlights to literally none. In fairness, subscribing to the Gold Pass does make the experience more bearable, just like in the last system. I already mentioned the additional green and gold pipes that subscribers get, but the 50 extra rubies you can earn from gold challenges, gold tour gifts, and gold monthly gifts bring the free ruby range from 54 through 119 to 104 through 169. That's not as high as the 114 through 219 range the Gold Pass was in before, but it is closer to the 64 through 169 range that free players were in before, with some extra gold pipes thrown in for good measure. If you're a free player who just wants a singular spotlight though, your only options are to religiously save Ruby's very special delicacy, grind online for a lucky multiplayer pipe, or spend money. As nice as the new free pipes are, the rewards are so scattershot and inconsistent that they don't really help in a day-to-day sense. Ultimately, to a purely casual player, the removal of gacha equates to the removal of options, which is more of a testament to how manipulative gacha can be and how difficult it can be to remove it than anything else. All of this exact number analysis really gets to why this update has been so controversial. The immediate combination of no more gacha, expensive spotlights, and reduced ranked rewards creates an experience that is almost comparable to the gacha days, but just underwhelming and greedy enough to feel worse. Is it actually worse? I'd honestly say no. In the previous weeks before the spotlight shop, Tour had some of its most predatory deals yet, with the gold Chargin' Chuck and King Mario pipes during the Bowser and Anniversary Tour. These were each limited 50-pull pipes containing brand new high-ends with the fan-favorite coin box item, and they were each not spotlights, meaning they were not guaranteed to appear by the time you emptied a pipe. If by your 50th pull you had not received a Charles of the Golden Hue, you had no choice but to reset the pipe again and again. And again, theoretically, you could spend thousands upon thousands of rubies and still not get these meta units. I know people who spent hundreds of rubies on these pipes without getting what they wanted. It sucks. I actually did get both of them though, funnily enough. I must have been visited by the Luck Fairy from the movie Luck, which I haven't seen because it was produced by a sex pest. Anyway, these kinds of practices in a kid's game were frankly kinda disgusting, and I think any move away from it is good in the long run, from both a consumer and business perspective. A casual player may not get new things quite as easily, but we're no longer expected to pay exorbitant funds for the mere chance of unlocking a video game character. Nintendo probably isn't raking in as much money without scams like the 50-pull pipes, but now their game isn't at risk of being banned from certain territories for featuring gambling. The new monetization is certainly scuzzy in its own ways, particularly with rubies now being harder to come by and ruby bundles being way too steep, but I at the very least appreciate the baby steps toward making a more enjoyable and accessible experience rather than ignoring the fans' feedback entirely. If there's one thing that makes Tour stand out among its mobile brethren, it's how willing the developers are to listen to fans. The game didn't start out all too great, we all know that by now, but over time the Tour team has responded to almost every foundational complaint, from the controls to the track selection to the battle mode to the gacha. While the promise of fixing things in the future isn't necessarily a great excuse for mediocrity in the present, it does show that behind the harsh, offensive money-making practices imposed by Nintendo, there are some developers who care about making an enjoyable Mario Kart game. It may take time for things to settle out, but personally I'm content to casually enjoy the experience until it gets even better or disappears entirely. Either way, it's been a pretty darn fun ride. Phew, time to never talk about Tour again and officially shift my channel to a Warped Kart Racers theme! Get warped into the ultimate kart racing game featuring the stars of 20th Television's hit animated shows, American Dad, Family Guy, King of the Hill, and Solar Opposites. Experience iconic locations and even some surprise ones in your quest for karting glory. Complete daily challenges to unlock new characters, skins, karts, and customizations. Check out the 1.2 American Dad update featuring the Smith's Dreamworld track, the new character Klaus, and new features such as private lobbies, legendary AI, and exclusive multiplayer rewards. Don't forget to comment below with your thoughts on the game and which characters and tracks you hope they add the most. I'm personally hoping for Bill Dotrieve, Chris Griffin, Glenn Quagmire, Ida Quagmire, Joe Swanson, Donna Swanson, Kevin Swanson, Susie Swanson, John Herbert, John Weed, John Shepard, Elmer Hartman, Mayor West, Carl Consuela, the Giant Chicken, Cleveland Brown, Donna Tubbs Brown, Cleveland Brown Jr., Roberta Tubbs, Rayo Tubbs, Tim the Bear, Mort Goldman, Neil Goldman, Carter Peterschmidt, Barbara Peterschmidt, Tom Tucker, Joyce Kinney, Trisha Takanawa, Ollie Williams, and Boomhauer. Click the link in the description below to find out more about Warped Kart Racers. Okay, the bit's done. I'm not gonna make Warped Kart Racers jokes anymore. Sorry, guys. It's over. Anyway, thank you all so much for watching, I really appreciate it. I'm sorry again for doubling up on Tour-related videos, this is probably going to be the last time I cover it now that I've discussed both its past and its future. If you want me to cover other things though, be sure to like, comment, subscribe, and consider donating to my Patreon. For as low as $3 to $5 a month, you can get an amazing set of perks including early access to new videos, your name listed in the credits, monthly behind-the-scenes blog posts, and an exclusive Discord server. The more support I get, the more time I can dedicate to the channel to make in-depth video essays like these, so be sure to click the link in the description below or go to patreon.com/jennygeist. Today I'll be giving a shout out to my patrons at the producer tier and above, those being Ace L, Chloe BC, Fusefall, Kitty Kongfax, Oski, Sammy, Simon Welsh, and Vincent Coates. Even if you can't donate though, liking, commenting, subscribing, and sharing are all still immensely helpful to me and it means the world. With that said, I hope you all have a wonderful day, and I will see you all later.